Okay, so hello everyone. My name is Silke Maas and I'm a PhD student at the KU Leuven under the supervision of Professor Leen de Sim. Today I will discuss with you the work we have done in our paper, which is titled SPH Modeling of Companion Perturbed HB Outflows, including a Morphologic Classification Scheme. Our paper was published in ANA earlier last month. So let's start with a brief introduction about the topic. So nowadays, we know that HB outflows exhibit a large diversity of structural complexities, as you can see, for example, on this figure, which is taken from the Atomium Large Project, displaying different HB stars. And as we have seen this before in this conference, it is now commonly believed that these morphologies mainly stem from the gravitational interaction between the HB with any stellar or planetary companion, which is often undetected. The aim of the work in our paper is to explore these wind-companion interactions from a global point of view, using 3D theoretical models. So we focused on the following four components in our paper. We analyzed the global density distribution of the HB outflow with a focus on the vertical wind extent. Next, we introduced a wind morphology classification parameter. And lastly, we also investigated the effect of the companion on the terminal expansion velocity. Now, what do our models look like and what are we using? So in our simulations, we model the hydrodynamics of a polytropic gas with the technique of smoothed particle hydrodynamics, but without the inclusion of extra cooling mechanisms, chemistry, dust, or radiation. Although the latter two are needed for the launching of the wind from the surface of the HB star, but this is replaced by including an effective gravitational potential in the momentum equation. The code that we have used is called Phantom, so it's an SPH code, and it's developed by Daniel Price and his collaborators. In our cutoff model, we vary three parameters, namely the initial wind velocity, where we switch between a fast wind and a slow wind. We vary the companion mass between a stellar and a planetary companion. And lastly, we have used four different values of binary separations, and these all correspond to closed binary systems. So in total, this brings us at 14 models where we have employed two models of Malfe et al. 2021. Now, let's move on to the results. So in this slide, I show you the four main morphologies that we have found in our simulations shown in the orbital plane. And as you can see, these are generally spiral patterns as we expect. So when the companion is of planetary type here on the left side, we find a quasi-spherical outflow with only a minor contrast spiral. Like minor density contrast spiral. When the companion is more massive and in a fast wind, this results in a distinct single spiral structure, as you can see here. Now, if we lower this wind velocity, this also creates a spiral pattern, but you can see that it has different characteristics. For example, in the inner wind, you can see that there is a double spiral emerging, and it quickly the two spirals quickly merge to one global spiral. Now, lastly, we find that if we also decrease the binary separation, we find that the spiral becomes perturbed. And in the next talk of Yolien Malfait, you will hear all about the cause of these perturbations in the outflow. However, this already indicates that already simple systems can create complex morphologies. Now, if we consider the morphologies in the meridional plane, so this is the plane perpendicular to the orbital plane, we generally find arc-like structures, definitely when the companion is massive enough. So the biggest difference between the models that I've shown here is that for certain configurations, the wind is compressed towards the orbital plane, as you can see, for example, in the cases on the right. And we see also that this compression leaves distinct signatures on the wind. And on this, I will elaborate in a moment. So let's move on to the analysis. We have performed three different analyses in our paper. So first of all, it is important that we investigate the vertical extent of the HB wind since, for example, around post-HB binary systems, there have been observed circumbinary disks. And we believe that the origin of these disks is most probably found in the HB phase, and therefore this gap needs to be bridged. Now to analyze this feature, I compared the mean density of different parts of the wind. So namely, I compared the mean density in a disk-like region around the orbital plane to the mean density in a tube along the polar axis, as you can see here schematically presented. So on this slide, I show you eight of our models. So these are the models which have a stellar companion. And in the dashed line, I give the mean density in the orbital plane, and the blue line gives the mean density along the polar axis. And you can, and the gray curve, it gives the ratio between those two densities. And this gray curve indicates that the matter is not distributed in the same way in the orbital plane as in polar, along the polar axis. Now, if we focus on only these four models, we can actually distinguish four different characteristics in these figures. So for the first model, which is a fast model, we see that globally the wind material is distributed more or less evenly between the orbital plane and the polar regions. Then for the second model that I've indicated here, which is the same as the first model, but now the companion is located more closely to the HB star, the mean density in the polar region starts to decrease from about 50 AU on. And also the gray curves indicate this clearly. So this means that higher up the polar region, there is a void present in the outflow. In comparison, we have model three, and here the mean density along the polar axis is much lower than in the orbital plane. However, there is no void present near the poles, since the gray curve is generally decreasing and not increasing. So models two and three, which I've indicated here, they both show some sort of compression of the wind material towards the orbital plane. However, their origin is different, and on that I will also elaborate in a moment. And then lastly, I indicate a fourth model here, and actually in this model we see a combined effect of the two previous ones. So to recap, we see four different signatures. So first of all, we have a global spherical outflow, by which I mean that the material reaches all longitudes and latitudes. Then the second model, it shows what we have called a flattening. And this is actually the result of the centrifugal effect of the orbital motion of the HB star induced by the companion. And this effect was already established previously by Kim and Tam in 2011. So then the other compressed signature, that is what is called an equatorial density enhancement. And this difference differs from the flattening, as it is the result of the gravitational pull of the companion on the HB wind. And this makes that the wind material is confined in the orbital plane. Then the last signature that we saw on the previous slide was actually a combination of this flattening and an EDE. So now whether or not a flattening or an EDE is present in the outflow, this depends on the orbital and wind properties of the system. So when the interaction between the companion becomes stronger, the more likely an EDE is to form. And on the other hand, when it's mainly the orbital motion of the HB star that is shaping its outflow, a flattening will result. Okay, let's move on to the classification parameter. So now we found these different observed morphologies. So they are different in the orbital plane and the meridional plane. And now we aim to classify these morphologies by some way by using a singular parameter, which is a combination of the system parameters. So based on the morphologies that we found in the simulations, we can actually divide our models in three major classes. So we find mainly spherical outflows or outflows that are showing regular spirals. And lastly, we also find highly perturbed spirals. So now we aim to find a parameter which is also able to make the same classification, but based on a certain value. And then once such a parameter is found, it can be used later to help retrieve useful information from the observations about the parameter of the observed system. Now, after applying different parameters to our models, some of which we have found in the literature that have been used for classification before, we came to the conclusion that this parameter shown on the slides is able to give an accurate classification. So this parameter, we call it epsilon, is the ratio of the gravitational energy density of the companion to the kinetic energy density of the wind. And it therefore is composed of the main parameters of the HB system. So this means it contains the wind velocity, the binary properties, and also the two masses of the components. In this graph, I show you our 14 models on the x-axis, and on the y-axis you can see its calculated epsilon value. So the fill style of the different symbols indicates the type of morphologies that we found in the in simulations. So we see that for low values of epsilon, this corresponds to this quasi-spherical morphologies. Models with a value of epsilon around one exhibit a simple and single spiral. And then we find that the more larger values for epsilon correspond to the complex and more perturbed simulations. So this means that we can actually find the following classification scheme that I show here on the slide. And by this, we confirm that this epsilon parameter is able to divide our model in the same classes as what we have found for the morphology. And therefore, epsilon is a suited classification parameter. Then lastly, we investigate the effects of the companion on the terminal expansion velocity of the wind. Because of course, this is an important observational property that we want to find for the AGP winds. So with this graph, I present again our 14 models. And then on the y-axis in circles, I present their terminal velocity. And in the dashed line, this is the terminal velocity of the simulation, but then without a companion. And as you can see already here, it's clear that the companion does affect the terminal velocity. Now to investigate the cause of this deviation, we constructed a toy model. So we calculated analytically the terminal velocity, and that would, so what the terminal velocity would be purely due to the effect of the gravitational potential of the companion. So in green, you can see the results here. So we see that for the planetary models, this toy model explains very well the observed, or the found terminal velocity. However, for our stellar models, so the models with a stellar companion, there is an important acceleration mechanism missing because the resulting terminal velocity of the toy model is negative.
1 minute. Therefore,
okay, thank you. Therefore, we included another mechanism to our toy model, namely the slingshot mechanism. So this states that by conservation of energy and momentum, a small object moving past a large body in motion is accelerated or decelerated. And if we also include the slingshot in our toy model, this gives the results in purple. And you can see that this can explain the terminal velocities of our models with a stellar companion and is even necessary to get the terminal velocities. So to conclude my talk and therefore also our paper, we have found that for companion perturbed AGB outflows, a small parameter space already gives a large variation in morphologies, and that we can reach quite complex and perturbed morphologies already for very simple systems. From the analysis of the vertical wind extent, we found that we can differentiate between a flattening and an equatorial density enhancement, which are both caused by a distinct mechanism. Then we also have found a parameter, which we called epsilon, that stems in an accurate classification scheme. And lastly, we can conclude that the terminal wind velocity is affected by the companion, mainly due to the gravitational slingshot mechanism. So I thank you all for listening, and I'll be happy to take your questions.
Thank you very much. Adam, please.
That was a beautiful talk, beautifully organized, very clear. Thank you. My question is, so the equatorial density enhancement is, you know, if we go back to the generalized interstellar or interacting wind models, excuse me, that was the key component. And I'm wondering how much can you get out of this? How much higher density can you get in the equator than in the poles?
That's actually a good question. We didn't really look into the ratio between the orbital plane and the polar axis, but here you can already see some ratios, but we mainly looked here at the different signatures that it leaves on. But now there will, we need to investigate more, of course, what these equatorial density enhancements are and how much it differs with the polar regions.
Yeah, and it depends also on where, right? You'd like it to be relatively close, but of course, I mean, it's not, you know, probably on the AU, it's about resolution 50 AU to 100 AU still, maybe enough to give us the large scale 10 to the 16, 10 to the 17 sizes, the collimation on those sizes. So I'll thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we move to Australia.
Hi, thank you, Silke. That was very nice. Is your companion fixed or is it free to move? It's free to move, right? Because you have reflex motion of the AGB star. The orbital distance is free. You're not keeping it at a constant value.
Yeah, so for our models, for example, this model, we start at 9 AU and there is a slight evolution orbital separation, but it doesn't change much over our evolution time of the simulation.
Okay, I guess my question then is, on the smallest companion, the 0.01, there's no migration of the orbit at all?
At some point long ago, I looked into that, but it was really minor. So it's because all the accretion of the wind material is not correctly implemented yet in these simulations that it's actually not physically true yet how the migration goes. But it changes a bit, but it's not really physical yet in the simulations.
And what is the time scale of the simulation?
So these simulations are all between 5 and 10 orbits, so depending on the spinal separation.
Okay, any more comments, question? Tomek.
Hi, great talk. So did I see correctly that the slingshot effect is strongest for planetary companions? You got the last plot where for the planetary models, you get even higher values than those without the slingshot effect.
Yes, that's true. But that's mainly because for our toy model, as we in purple here, we only calculate for like one particle. And in the simulation with planetary models, there are actually not very much SPH particles that come close enough to the HB star, to the companion star, I mean, to really be accelerated. So that's why for the planetary models, this is really exaggerated.
I see, thank you.
Okay, yes. Vero, Laura, please.
Yes, thank you. I was just wondering in the slide where you show the different spirals, that one. So the last one where you have this spiral that is irregular, as you said, that is a consequence only of the orbit that you're using?
Yes.
Or you are perturbing in another way, like we were seeing yesterday from both stars having winds, or it's just
It's just the orbit. So this model and then the one furthest right, they're both the same except for the orbital separation. So.
Okay.
But you're leaving in a moment, we'll talk about it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's move to the next talk.